4 is going to be wild. Got to keep your head on a swivel. The truth shall set you free. And the truth is now coming out about the Biden regime. The truth being written by a dear friend of us, somebody who I've known for quite a while, Charlie Spiering. It's awesome. The former Breitbart White House reporter is out with a brand new book called Amateur Hour, where he details the life and times of Kamala? Not even she knows how to say it. She said it like 50 different times in his brand new book, Amateur Hour, Kamala Harris in the White House. Sounds like it could be a great comedy screenplay. The great Charlie Spiering joins us now. Charlie, congratulations on the book. We have a regular segment on the show called the Kamala Cringe Alert, where we have this massive cringe siren goes off and we play some type of cringe from the Biden White House. Sometimes it's Kamala. Sometimes
I would expect nothing less on your show.
Maybe we'll do one during our interview, but hey.
You never know.
You've been making massive headlines for this. You did some wild reporting here, in-depth reporting, and you found out that Joe Biden really doesn't like Kamala Harris. Is that correct?
That's correct, Benny. Joe Biden is just really struggling to really get along with Kamala. He always wanted a kind of a buddy vice president. He always wanted somebody who could be a true partner. But the first 3 years of Kamala have sort of demonstrated that she's just not up to the job. She's multiple failures, some thin-skinned grievances. She's sort of toxic behind the scenes, not very helpful, wriggles out of tough assignments. Kamala is for Kamala. So she's just really sort of trying to protect her political brand while still being sort of waiting Joe out at back in the White House.
Now, apparently the long knives are out from Jill as well. And Jill, clearly the muscle behind this operation, as Joe Biden can barely get up the stairs.
Right. The caretaker.
And Jill, that's right. So Jill Biden, between changing bedpans, Jill Biden is apparently trying to do a changing of the guard in the VP position. She doesn't like Kamala. It's pretty toxic, no?
Well, back in 2020, when Joe Biden eventually picked Kamala, that was not his first choice. He favored Gretchen Whitmer in Michigan and felt that she would be better for the campaign. She was a woman who liked fixing roads. So Joe Biden really liked that, right?
Yeah.
So then,
and the roads haven't been fixed. So talk to anyone in Michigan.
So anyway, his senior advisors, Obama himself, were like, sorry, Joe, you need a woman of color on the ticket because you look like a real idiot when you're out there talking about racial issues. And this was during the summer of the George Floyd riots. Mm-hmm. So that's why he ended up picking her. But he can't replace her at this point without angering the base he was trying to please in 2020. So basically, they're sort of Kamala is Kamala. Here we go. And they're just praying that Joe Biden makes it to Election Day.
So it's like the Pope criticizing someone for being too Catholic, Joe Biden criticizing Kamala for being incapable of speaking. But that is apparently something that happens. Like, they're embarrassed at Kamala's performance. Is that correct? Is that what you've found in your research for this book?
That's right. There were so many word salads during the first 3 years, so many obviously flubbed interviews, even though she had done media training, that famous clip with Lester Holt. Her staff actually prepped her how to answer, why haven't you been to the border? So the fact that she wasn't even prepared for that was shocking. She was very angry about being labeled the border czar by the Republicans, did everything she could to remind people, I am only focused on the root causes. I have nothing to do with the border. That's why she's just totally gone AWOL on the entire issue. The Biden team was just horrified at her performance and really don't want her to focus on that. That's why they put her in charge of abortion now. That's her safe space. So that's why she's sort of kept in her nice little safe sandboxes where she can talk about issues that she's comfortable with.
Good. Oh, yeah. From child trafficking to child genocide. That's great. Right. Just a really easy pivot there. Fantastic. Let's all worship Moloch together. So, speaking of somebody who you're obviously talking about the Biden White House and how they're horrified at her performance, but could you really blame them for being so dense? Kamala Harris is on stage. We have the clip. We play it pretty often. Kamala Harris is on stage a couple months before the general election in 2020, looks straight down the barrel at Joe Biden and goes, you're the kind of Jim Crow racist that kept little brown girls like me from going to school. She straight up says it to his face. And Joe Biden goes, right? And looks over at her. Mm-hmm. And so then you hire someone like that. You hire someone that toxic into your administration. The person that says, you kept me from going to school because of my skin color. It's like what Kamala Harris like literally says to Joe. What do you expect, I guess, is my question. You're the guy who's done the research. Like, this seems like a match made in hell.
The Biden family was not happy with the idea. Jill was not happy with the idea. She preferred Susan Rice of, the Benghazi infamy over Kamala Harris. And because it was a very personal attack. Kamala Harris was a friend of his son, Beau Biden. Kamala Harris went to Beau Biden's funeral with the family. And for her to stab Joe in the back like this, and then for him to turn around and pick her as the vice presidential candidate, it was deeply shocking to friends of the family.
Yeah. I mean, the clip, which is, you know, playing beside us, she's like, you opposed busing and you opposed me going to school. I mean, she straight up says you're the old timey, dusty racist, Jim Crow racist that holds hands with KKK Grand Wizards, which he did, and that opposed girls with my skin color going to school. Now, leaving aside the actual argument itself, which has a lot more nuance, this does seem to be something that is utterly disqualifying for the vice presidency position. But what does this say about Joe Biden that Kamala was then forced into that position as a diversity hire?
Yeah, that's the problem. Joe Biden's not actually in charge. It's his senior advisors that do most of the work. Senior advisors had to make the case. He's also sort of beholden to Jim Clyburn, the politician that endorsed him in South Carolina that finally revived that flailing campaign and brought him home a big victory in South Carolina. Jim Clyburn also wanted him to pick Kamala Harris. Al Sharpton actually didn't like Kamala Harris right in the beginning. He actually wanted Stacey Abrams, but he was kind of forced to hold his tongue and go along with the ultimate pick. And of course, the greatest of all, Barack Obama. He was the one that helped Joe walk through the process and reassure him, hey, Joe, it's just politics. It's going to be okay. You can do this. And that's even though Obama left the ultimate decision to Joe ultimately, you know, they helped him along a little bit. It's kind of how the presidency works at this point.
Yeah. Helped him along like a rascal at Walmart. Yeah. Like Joe Biden rolling through, getting ready for activity hour at the senior center.
This is your decision. Good decision, Joe. Good job.
you get extra cinnamon on your applesauce today.
Yay.
So you're handicapping here about what happens next. Donald Trump's out here saying Joe's not going to make it to the election. Some people are out here saying they're going to do the switcheroo with Kamala. Some people saying Michelle Obama. You've done the actual research. What say you?
Democrats right now are just praying that Joe Biden crosses the finish line to Election Day. The last thing they want is for him to have to step down, and then it'll force absolute chaos in the Democrat Party. Kamala will step up to take his place. There will be thousands of Democrat donors, wealthy donors with money flowing out of their pockets that are going to say, no way, this is not going to happen. Bring us anybody else. Let's get Pete Buttigieg up here. Let's get Elizabeth Warren, even AOC. Let's get AOC on stage. But how do you get rid of your first historic first black vice president, black woman vice president? How you kick her out and replace her with somebody of any other caliber? The only person who could do that would be maybe Michelle Obama. So there's a reason why Democrats kind of want her to be open to the idea in case Joe Biden can't even make it to Election Day.
I will say, Charlie, that I would contend and argue with you here that you could replace Kamala Harris with Elizabeth Warren. And here's why. Because on the diversity intersectionality, Kamala Harris has, I believe her mother is Indian, like from India. Right. And Elizabeth Warren is an Indian. And so you could, on the hierarchy of intersectionality, you could potentially say same, you know, and who knows? I don't make the rules. It's Elizabeth Warren, right? She said she has high cheekbones and believe all women. So
I think Obama needs to hear that. That would be, he would be very interested in that theory.
How do these people get away with it? Okay. So final question. You did so much research for this book. What is the cringiest thing that you have that is in this book about Kamala Harris?
Kamala cringe. Benny, just going back and looking at her career, at her presidential campaign, it was just so bad. And I was more focused on other Democrat candidates in the 2020 primary, but taking a look in depth of her presidential campaign, it was a disaster. There were so many word salads, so many cringy moments. There's a reason why she fell flat in Iowa and couldn't even get to the date of the Iowa caucus. She ended her campaign wasting $40 million before voters even had a chance to deliver their verdict. That's kind of the scary thing. You look at Kamala Harris, if Joe Biden gets reelected, Kamala Harris could be the next president in just a few weeks after he's elected, just a few months, and she will have never faced a presidential election of her own. That's why I wrote the book. I want everybody to know all about Kamala Harris, be able to talk about her in a way that isn't just the words, that goes a little deeper than the word salad, so you know how to talk to friends and family about why she's, how she got here and why she's so bad. And why, if you vote for Joe Biden, you hear politicians saying, Republicans saying this all the time, if you're voting for Joe Biden, you're voting for Kamala Harris, President Kamala Harris, the next president of the United States. So it's a little terrifying, it's a little scary, but it's also hilarious. So please pick up the book. I had a great time writing it. It's so great to, after a year of research and writing, to hang out and talk about it. And thanks so much for having me on.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Charlie. You're welcome to stay around for the Kamala Harris cringe alert. We do have Kamala Harris's favorite cringes all lined up. And this one's for you, Charlie. Everyone go out and get Amateur Hour. Everyone go out and get Amateur Hour. It's amazing, and it is quite telling, and it's time for us to actually do some work on who Kamala Harris is, because none of us really know. Remember, Montel Williams had to introduce her to all of us. Look, this is Kamala. Remember that? Yeah. Such an embarrassing. Look, it's Kamala. Montel Williams. And he's got like four side chicks, and Kamala's just one of them. Oh, yeah. Man. Okay. All right. Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. The cringe alert. Kamala, nuclear. This is the nuclear cringe. This one's very, very important.
Oh, my gosh. It has to be the best.
We preserve this. We preserve this only for the most nuclear cringe moments of Kamala. Here we go.
Well, the press is here. I got some words. I got the vocabulary. And my pronunciation is perfect. Don't hear no. I eat no for breakfast. Don't hear no. Always believe in what can be, unburdened by what has been. Oh,
I love Venn diagrams. I love Venn diagrams. I'm telling you, whenever I'm facing like a conflict and I need to sort it out, give me a Venn diagram every day of the week, right?
I will tell you, I love this Gen Z generation. They are so spectacular. First of all, let me say, Joe, it's so good to see you. I haven't seen you since you were at my house a couple weeks ago for our hip hop party.
This is getting weird.
Anthony, huge fan, mad respect for you. And Alexander, I can't wait to see you at the White House one day very soon.
Wow, that's great. I saw some clips I have not seen before in that montage. So good work.
It's actually really hard to condense them, but we do our best. We are humble servants of the internet, and we are thankful that you've written this book, Charlie. Godspeed, sir.
Thank you for having me on, Benny. Great show. Keep going and keep that smile on your face.
Happy, can't defeat a happy warrior, right? Can't defeat an army of happy warriors. The salty army marches on. Thank you for adding some salt to our cup.
Anytime, Benny.
See you, Charlie. Ladies and gentlemen, Charlie had to go, but we do have one more small cringe for you. It's a clip that my producer, ALX, the great ALX, provided for us. Kamala, look at my bus. This is our just regular, not a nuclear cringe, just a regular cringe alert.
Look at my bus! Oh my God, I love it! Oh, wow. Look at the bus!
That's what I do every morning. I go downstairs like, look at my coffee. Oh my God, I love it. I got my coffee. God, got the salty army on it. Oh, it's so salty. What is wrong with these people? We are led by such morons. And maybe there will be some accountability.